When we first talked about visiting Iceland that summer, back in January 1968, I don't think any of us really felt we'd find ourselves bouncing over the desolate potholes on the trip north from Reykjavik. But with encouragement from the physics department at Southampton University, a lot of help from people like the RAF who flew us out, here we were on the 17-hour drive to our planned base camp near the Tungnafelsjökull glacier. We marked out the site on the corner of a small plain about midday on the 18th of July. We'd just missed the last snows of winter as we set about unloading a two-month supply of donated food and equipment, and then erected our tents. I was taking most of the pictures on the expedition, but they wouldn't let me get out of all the work. While Gerald Price, a physicist whose home is in Devon, cooked up our first meal, we discussed our plans for the next few days. Kit Reeve, the expedition leader, wanted to get on with the scientific equipment while Dr. Michael Rycroft, head of the Space Radio Physics Group at Southampton, was still with us. He had to leave for a conference in Canada after a few days. It was his interest in very low frequency and extremely low frequency radio physics which had provided us with much of our research program and gave Kit the basis for his postgraduate work. John Leach, another physicist, was the expedition's odd job man, and Bill Salter, our geologist. After the meal, Gerald attempted to burn the first of our rubbish. Theoretically, petrol, paper and matches should have started something. Martin, or Wilbur Whale, our ace mechanic, gave him lots of encouragement, but no help. Gerald needn't have worried much. We had many a laugh at Wilbur's expense in the weeks that followed. Kit soon got down to the exacting work of calibrating the equipment on which we hoped to record natural radio emissions in the VLF band, that is, from 300 Hz to 30 kHz. We left him to it and set off back to Hekla to pick up the rest of our petrol. After a mile and a half back across country, we regained the track or main road and started to take a closer interest in the grand but desolate scenery. Unfortunately, when you're 80 miles from the nearest habitation, this isn't always a good idea. Well, the second attempt at crossing the bridge was a little more successful. Suffering only a shaking, we pushed on to the next disaster. We were in good company this time, and were able to help a group of Icelanders get one of their vehicles free. We didn't know it, but they were going to amply repay us later. Back at camp, K Kit was getting ready to coordinate our recordings with those made at Chilbolton, near Winchester, and South Uist, in the Hebrides. Setting up the equipment was easy enough, but getting it to work well was by no means as simple. Various items had suffered during the journey out. Some suffered during the setting up procedure, and some had not been fully tested before we left Southampton. It took many long hours of tinkering, adjusting, and lashing up to get everything straight. Bill Salter doubled as an electronics man and built an audio amp from spares. Between them, he and Kit finally satisfied Michael that the system was up to scratch. After we'd said goodbye to the Icelanders, and just a mile from camp, Wilbur radioed Kit to ask him to put supper on. We arrived back on foot several hours later. The next day saw all six of us digging the old ambulance out. Apparently, melting of the top 2 feet of frozen glacial till results in thixotropic bogs, which are quite firm until disturbed, when they become very fluid. Anyway, the lorry was up to its differentials in the stuff. Here's where a good deed paid off. By sheer chance, the same people we'd helped the day before now rescued us from our predicament. One of the most enjoyable sides to the expedition was the marvellous friendship we encountered amongst the Icelanders. It made up for the isolation we felt at the camp. Once the equipment was working properly, we soon settled into a fairly simple work routine. These signals, from lightning discharges, are propagated in the Earth ionosphere waveguide. While the pen recorders ran continuously, the duty crew made tape recordings of any interesting emissions, like the chorus. Analysis of this information will help us understand the structure and processes of the ionosphere and magnetosphere. The routine allowed plenty of time for Wilbur to replace the clutch on the lorry, which had burnt out whilst it was bogged down. Every now and again, we ran into the usual problems associated with operating delicate scientific equipment in the field. On this occasion, a routine calibration gave us some trouble. The magnetometer was recording variations in the magnetic field, which we wanted to correlate with the signals our other equipment was picking up. We calibrated the instruments against each other every 48 hours. Quite often, the wind drove fine sand into the pen recorder mechanism, involving lengthy cleaning. But this time, it was just the trolls kicking the amplifier off the table. By the end of the expedition, we were all experts at debugging the complicated equipment. By the beginning of August, the last days of continuous daylight were behind us, and we found more and more of our work was done in the Icelandic twilight. The change came gradually and was welcome, because the long hours of sleep we found we needed came more easily in the hours of darkness. During an intensive 24-hour recording session, towards the end of our stay, we managed to get recordings of ELF cavity resonances, the first time this had been done in these latitudes. The routine work carried on round the clock. We were very glad there were enough of us to spread the load comfortably. Apart from the lorry's persistent affinity for bogs, the wind was our only major natural hazard. We discovered we could expect a major gale roughly once a week, but the first one or two took us by surprise. All the tents took a beating, and the ridgepole of the mess tent snapped. The answer lay in erecting stone defense works. We loaded the Land Rover on the nearby hills, and then built windbreaks round the tents. With all our possessions likely to end up in Reykjavik, we put our backs into the work. The next day turned out to be the best of the summer, but Bill told us there was another gale on the way, so we decided to make quite certain that the tents were secure. There was no dodging the work for me this time either. We took a snack lunch that day because Gerald, Wilbur and I were setting off for a tour around the country that afternoon. With everything now running smoothly, the recording could be handled by Kit, Bill and John, giving us a few days to sightsee. To Reykjavik, past Hekla, the island's most active volcano, and camped in the municipal camping ground by the swimming pool. We found a truly international community there, with students from practically all European countries, and several from North America. We swapped stories of our experiences in the interior, and we were surprised to learn that there were up to 40 other expeditions on the island that summer. Also the object of much interest on the part of the local children. After exploring the neat and prosperous city and calling in at a travel agency that had been particularly helpful earlier, we stopped by the statue commemorating the first parliament to be set up anywhere in Europe. Reykjavik contrasts strongly with the isolation further north, and we were not at all surprised to learn that nearly half the country's population lives in the capital city. From Reykjavik, we travelled north to the Ísafjord Peninsula, and then along the coast to Akureyri, the only large town in the north and an important fishing port. Akureyri itself is a very pleasant town, as neat and clean as Reykjavik, and very much in the style of Scandinavian towns. On this trip, we really appreciated Iceland's claim to be a land of contrasts. The total absence of trees became more and more apparent as we pushed on to the lake at Mývatn and the sulphurous hot springs at Namaskar, just to the south. Iceland's great potential for hydroelectric power is only just beginning to be exploited. There are plans to harness this and similar rivers throughout the country. In Mývatn was the scene of a great feast of millions of insects on us. Wilbur tried to give us some relief by lighting his pipe. It only made matters worse. Perhaps what we really needed was a jet of Namaskar's superheated steam. As we set off on the last lap south, with Wilbur driving, another unfortunate mishap occurred a few miles further on from the ford. By the time we got a local farmer to tow us out of the ditch, we were 18 hours overdue at camp, and only just caught Kit and John leaving in the lorry to inform the Mountain Rescue Service. The weather was turning noticeably colder as we completed the last of our recordings at the site. By this time, we had accumulated enough data for several years' work of analysis and interpretation, and we were very pleased with our results. The last series of recordings were taken on the 5th of September, and we had already begun dismantling the camp. For the last couple of days, we moved into a traveller's hut on the main track, in the company of a mountain rescue group returning from a mission in the north. We'd already decided to donate the lorry to the Mountain Rescue Service on our return home. Our list of mishaps wasn't quite complete, however. This little episode occurred on the road to Reykjavik, and what appeared to be a perfectly hard shoulder slid gently sideways. Apart from covering Gerald with marmalade, it caused no casualties. On the last night, we contented ourselves with relaxing in comfort under a solid roof for the first time in 2 months. We were pleased with the way everything had turned out, but none of us was sorry to be leaving the desolate plateau. The next morning, we packed the last of our personal belongings and climbed aboard the vehicles. The first snows of winter had dusted the hills overnight as we pulled away from the hut on the long drive home. The really important work of the expedition, analysing our results, still lay before us. Aided by the physics department, we managed to complete this film, and the university helped us to publish a full report of the expedition. Whichever way we looked at it, it had been a summer well spent.